evening church on this cool, delightful August morning, which of course is not true at all, but anyway, glad you're all here. Please notice the announcements in the bulletin. Next Sunday, it did make it into the bulletin, but next Sunday there will be a young family's ice cream social after church. I don't know what the definition of young families is, and I don't think they're going to be carding anybody, but there will be an ice cream social next Sunday after church. Notice the announcements in the bulletin. We continue our summer worship schedule. Notice the schedule for the young folks in the Tuesday morning book club. And then if your picture in the online church directory is not your best side, try to find one, and you can send in a different picture. Also, notice especially, it's hard to believe because it is August, but believe it or not, fall is coming, and usually we do gear up in the fall for our programming, and we're still trying to explore what that may mean, but part of that is all sharing our spiritual gifts with each other. So be reflecting on what you think God has gifted you, or what you can bring, or what spiritual gift you see in someone else, and as we try to pull together our life together as a community of faith. And because I need every extra point I can get, I'm going to go ahead and say Tuesday is my 47th wedding anniversary to that pretty gal over there. So happy anniversary, darling. And I hope you feel the same. Let us begin our worship by joining in the call to worship. I will bless the Lord at all times. God's praise shall continually be on my lips. Let the humble hear and be glad. The Lord is near to the brokenhearted and saves the crushed in spirit. Blessed are those who take refuge in the Lord. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt God's name together.
Thank you.
God and confess our sins because how wide and good God's grace is. Let us pray our prayer confession together. Gracious God, some of us come grief-stricken or downcast. Others of us come in an attitude of celebration. Some of us face difficult decisions and uncertainty. Others of us face the excitement of a new challenge. Some of us feel burdened by the disability or disease. Others of us feel keen appreciation for the good health we enjoy. Some of us sense a numbing despair at the problems in our world. Others of us sense opportunities to live out our faith. Whatever the state of our spirits, loving God, we share a common need for forgiveness and acceptance and your continuing guidance in our lives. In Christ's name we pray. Christ, we know that when we confess our sins, God's cast them away as far as the east is from the west and the north is from the south. Friends, believe the good news in Jesus Christ. Our first scripture reading is taken from the Psalms, from Psalm 111. Hallelujah! I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart in the assembly of the upright in the congregation. Great are the deeds of the Lord. They are studied by all who delight in them. O Lord, your work is full of majesty and splendor, and your righteousness endures forever. You make your marvelous works to be remembered. You are gracious and full of compassion. You give food to those who fear you. You are ever mindful of your covenant. You have shown your people the power of your works in giving them the lands and the nations. The works of your hands are faithfulness and justice. All your commandments are sure. They stand fast forever and ever because they are done in truth and equity. You send redemption to your people. You command it your covenant forever. Holy and awesome is your name. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Those who act accordingly have a good understanding. The praise of the Lord endures forever. The word of the Lord. At this time, the children will come forward for a time with Barbara.
Hello, everybody. So tell me, if you can read it, what does my mask say? What does it say?
It says show love.
Show love. We talk about that a lot around here because our high school is called Show, and this is kind of our theme, showing love. Why do you think that we made that our theme? What do you think? Do you think that's a good thing for people to do? Do you think that's a way to help each other? We actually think it's kind of like we're showing everybody what God's love is like. And what we found is when we do that, even a little bit, it's like we have a superpower. We went, like this summer, we worked on a house, and if we all did our own little job, it was like a superpower because we were able to paint and fix a whole house. And these guys aren't much older than you. Like Eli, you're almost old enough to be doing this with us. And we had people, but the thing is, we couldn't do every job. Like, I had been to the doctor and I couldn't get up on the ladders, so somebody else had to get up on those ladders because I had to stay off ladders for that week. We had one of our moms who was a nurse who came and she was there to help us. We had people that were good at painting. We had people that were good with hammers. We had people that were good with scrapers. And we all worked together and we fixed a whole house. Can you believe it? And what I think is so interesting is that no little part of love, no little act of love is too small. Have you guys, what did you do this week? Did you start school? How many of you started school this week? Yeah. Did you see any kids that were new kids that might need a friend? Yep, that might need to be invited in to play? You can show love like that too. You can show God's love like that. And what was really nice is if you know some of the stories in the Bible, they talk about that. There's kids your age in the Bible that actually knew that people were hungry. And so one little boy offered his lunch and it fed a whole bunch of people and that's how they showed God's love. It's like a superpower, isn't it? Do you think you have the power to do that? Yeah, and maybe someone that's doing something nice for you, you can say thank you, you can hug them. I get upset because I try to show people I'm smiling behind a mug, but I think behind a mask, but I think people know that, don't they? So we all have superpowers, and that's kind of what we're saying to the moms and dads and friends in the church too, is that we all can do, even the smallest thing shows God's love, and together, that is a superpower in the world. All right, let's say a prayer, and then you guys get to go downstairs. Gracious God, we thank you for all the gifts you've given us, the things that we're able to do, even the smallest things that can make a huge difference in showing your love in the world. Amen.
The rain of yesterday and last night brings with it some much needed nourishment in my poor yard. It also stirs up some things for we allergy sufferers that we had rather left not stirred up. So I apologize in advance. We're reading today, just about to finish our walk through this little letter, the letter to the Ephesians. As I've said earlier, we believe it was written to people with a very diverse background who really did not have any kind of foundation in Judaism, certainly the Christian faith. So the author, more than other letters of this ilk, seems to go back and reiterate some of the basics and some of the foundations of what this faith tradition incurs. But now we're in the fifth chapter in these series of practical advice, so to speak, and I'm reading from just a few verses. Verses 15 through 20. Therefore, there it is again. Be careful how you live, not as unwise people, but as wise, making the most of the time, because the days are evil. So do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. Do not get drunk with wine. So there's nothing about beer or bourbon, so we're good. Yeah. For that is debauchery. But be filled with the Spirit. As you sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs among yourselves, singing and making melody to the Lord in your hearts, giving thanks to God the Father at all times and for everything, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. This is the word of the Lord. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. I often stumbled on that phrase as a child, as a young adult, as a young pastor. Fear. Raised in a tradition that liked to put the, quote, fear of God into you. That you could scare people into the kingdom of God. You could frighten them into living the Christian life. And it seemed to be a mixed message for me. I was told about this Jesus who loves me, who is my friend that I can pray to, who cares for me, but I better look out for God, who at any time might pull out a big can of whoops smite. How can you love God and fear God at the same time? I read an essay a few years ago by a wonderful Jewish rabbi named Abraham Heschel, who talked about two types of fear. He said, there is a kind of fear that drives you away. It paralyzes you because of, you know, you may be afraid of the consequences, and so you don't do anything. But he said, there is a kind of fear that can mobilize you, that lures you in to want to learn more. It's scary, but it's also an exciting kind of fear. I think you may have used the example of you get a new position you applied for. You didn't think you would get it, but you did, and it's kind of scary, but you're gonna go for it, for this new chapter in your life. He said that's what the Bible means by the fear of the Lord, that sense of awe and wonder. Wisdom begins in awe and wonder as we open ourselves to God's wisdom. And Lord knows we need some wisdom for the living of these days. As we muddle our way through this pandemic with masks and vaccines, how to best protect our children. Parents need wisdom about just sending their children to school. We need wisdom for the emotional and psychological effects of what this does to all of us. We need wisdom on how to handle and deal with the grief that we feel about our lives, about those lives that have been lost. We need wisdom as we witness again and again the disturbing and very dramatic effects of climate change, to the point that even the climate changer deniers are going, you know, there's something going on here. Really? We need wisdom in how we treat others, speak to others. As we see also the dramatic and violent effects of this systemic racism that's part of our culture and the sexism that is so pervasive. We need wisdom for daily living, which actually could be the subtitle for this little letter to the Ephesians, at least once you get to the therefores. I was sort of making a joke about that for the last couple of weeks, therefore, 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 but it really is a way, I think, for the author to say, look, all of this stuff that we've been talking about, all this, you know, the cosmic Christ who's brought peace to the cosmos and all this stuff, this is how it applies to your daily lives. Let's take this theology and funnel it down here and see what it means for the way you live day to day. If you're following Christ, if you are part of this faith tradition, you've been adopted into the faith. He says chosen, predestined. You see the word predestination more in this little letter than in any other book in the Bible just about, which is conclusive proof that the author was a Presbyterian. And you think you made the decision to be part of the Christian faith, or you made the decision to come this morning. Not really. On a human level, you did, but really it's because God's Spirit was working in our lives and in our world, luring you. And you can resist that Spirit, or you can, as the Buddhists say, go with the flow. And in Jesus Christ, we see God's purpose for our lives and for our world. And there, in His life, in His teaching, in His death and resurrection, we see God's unfathomable love, which is so transformative that it changes our world, which I've said before, this love supports you, carries you through any obstacle that you can face, carries you even beyond death. And he says, you have an inheritance in heaven. It's there. It's waiting on you. So you don't have to worry about whether you get in or who's out. It's there. The first therefore. If that be true, then don't live in fear. Live in hope. And also that love has broken down, he says, all the walls of hostility between peoples and created this cosmic peace that creation is moving toward. A love that reveals to us that there's only one race of people, and that's the human race. Therefore, grow into that love. Reflect it in your life, individually, to grow in patience, to grow in compassion, to grow in kindness and forgiveness. Reflect it in your community. Reflect it as a community. How? As we talked about last week, speak the truth with your neighbors. We're members of one another. We're all in this together. I had a cranky old professor in college who I just absolutely adored. His snarkiness was contagious. I think that's what I liked about him. He had these little pet peeves, and one of them was when the word Christian was used as an adjective. And so he would do this little riff in class, and we'd heard it hundreds of times, and it was still wonderful. We'd talked about the Christian that woke up in the morning and had a Christian cup of coffee, and they got into their Christian car while listening to Christian music and went to the Christian bookstore wearing their favorite pair of Christian socks, and he'd go on and on. And then he would say, look, there was only one Christian, and he got killed. The rest of us are in the process of trying to be one. And that kind of stuck with me. I would qualify that in a bunch of ways, but that notion is that, look, we're all in the process of becoming Christian, and we stumble, and we fail, and we fall. But I think that's why the author says, be careful how you live. That is to say, be intentional. Be deliberate about this. Patience don't come natural. Forgiveness doesn't come natural. You have to be deliberate about it. Be deliberate about your faith journey. That the process of becoming a Christian doesn't occur by osmosis. You have to be deliberate about your faith journey. And to do so is to live as a wise person. A wise person, just in the little verses that we looked at today, what makes someone wise as opposed to being foolish? He says, a wise person makes the most of the time. Make the most of the time. It's funny when you look at some different translations of that little phrase, the things you get. Use your time wisely. Make every moment count. Seize every opportunity. I think it was that great theologian, Captain Picard, on Star Trek that once said, is time an enemy that takes away from us everything we love, everything we are? Or is time a friend that reminds us of how precious life really is and what's important? The Greek verb that I know you all are very curious about actually comes from the marketplace. It's to redeem time, to buy back time. Wouldn't it be great if you could buy back some time in the marketplace? Don't miss a bargain. 2 for 1 today only, because once it's gone, it's gone. And it goes by so fast. It's interesting this time of year as people are going back to school and they're putting the Facebook photos up there of the first day of school, and I'm seeing these kids here and it's like, so-and-so, today, first day of 8th grade. And I'm like, 8th grade? I just baptized them 2 months ago. Nebra, 8th grade, I just baptized them 2 months ago. She's like, honey, that was 2011. I was like, well, wasn't 2011 2 months ago? What's happening here? Where does the time go? was driving to church this morning, came around by Lakeshore. And coming around the curve there, you see the hill, the climbing, and there's a dad out there running. Well, just barely running along. And his little boy's running behind him. And couldn't have been taller than the dad's calf. I mean, it's like just little, but there he's going slow enough and he's following up there. And I just wanted to stop and get out of the car and say, oh, before you know it, he's going to be ahead of you running. Enjoy this time. It goes so fast. But remember, the author here is speaking to the churches, to the collective churches, making the most of the time. To seize every opportunity to witness to the things of God. Climate change, for example. We don't have all the time in the world. We have to make the most of the time. Seize every opportunity to pursue justice. Don't miss an opportunity to care for one another. Make the most of every chance you get to encourage someone, to remind someone that they are a child of God. And he says, because the days are evil, which is a weird kind of translation. I don't think it means evil, satanic, just that we live in perilous times. We always live in perilous times. So make the most of them. Because something tragic could happen at any time. Life is so precious. And there are things that work against God's spirit. So look for every opportunity to be the people that God has called you to be. To be aware, he says. Oh, it's funny, all the admonitions in the Bible, drink a little wine for your stomach's sake, it's okay, moderation. Then this one is like, do not get drunk with wine. But it's a metaphor, right? Alcohol dulls the senses. You're not as sharp. You're not as alert. Be alert. Making the most of the time, being wise, is just being alert to the vicissitudes of life. And finally, he says, give thanks at all times and for everything. A wise person is a grateful person. But at all times, for everything? It's like pray without ceasing. Well, you mean 24/7? Come on. At all times and for everything. Cultivate a life of gratitude. I could give you a whole list of things, and you could double that list back to me of things that I'm not thankful for. But if we look, it's there. Because, see, it ties together. You have to be deliberate sometimes. You have to be intentional about thanksgiving, about gratitude. But when you are, it compels you to think hopefully. It compels you to look for the good in others and in yourself and in the world. And it challenges you to pause and make the most of the time that our good Lord has given us. May the God we come to know through Jesus Christ continue to give us wisdom for the living of these days. Hallelujah and amen.
We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God, created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to live with respect in creation, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus, crucified and risen, our judge and our hope, in life and death, and life beyond death. God is not alone. Thanks be to God. Please be seated. Please join me in prayer. Gracious God, we praise you. We thank you from the depths of our hearts and minds for the way you bless and guide your faithful people. Hope-giving God, even when the things of life cause us stress and anxiety, we know that the God we worship will continue to be with us, because that is who our faithful God always was and is to God's committed people. We lift up names of dear ones who struggle with a host of issues and situations over which we feel powerless. Remind us again that your power is sufficient for their needs. They are all in your loving care. Help us to place our trust and confidence in you. As our children and grandchildren have headed back to school and college to learn anew, help us to pass on to them the wisdom found in faith that has been given down to us from the generations before us. Help our children and grandchildren as they learn their daily lessons to listen and learn. Help their teachers have the patience and knowledge to teach well. Help us as we guide them through those lessons of faith we promised at their baptisms. Justice-loving God, you have created promises for your faithful people, promises that we can all rely upon and live by, promises that encourage us to seek to live lives that are just and holy, and lives that confront injustices in our community. And now, Lord, we look to the prayer that your Son gave the church, the prayer that has sustained us through good times and bad, through famine and plagues, through disasters and pandemics. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Okay, the ushers are ready now to take the offering. Please also note the friendship pad in the pew and sign that and pass that down of the pew. Let us worship God by sharing our gifts.
Thank you.
privilege it is to be able to share our gifts and our talents in your quest to make this world a place where people are loved and respected and cared for. The world knows a little bit less injustice and a little bit more of the joy of our love for each other. Yes, you bless these gifts in your name. Amen.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord be kind and gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and grant you peace from this day forward and forevermore. Amen. Thank you.